Hello and welcome to this event coming to you from Queen's Hall here at Parliament House. We're marking NAIDOC Week this year by presenting this discussion in partnership with the Parliament of Victoria, the Royal Society of Victoria, Victorian Parliamentarians for STEM, and in collaboration with the Indigenous Knowledge Institute at the University of Melbourne. I'm Bill Bainbridge, I'm one of the communications advisors here at the Parliament, and before I begin, I'd like to acknowledge the Wurundjeri people, the owners of the land on which we're having this discussion today, and we pay our respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging. We're joined today by two Wurundjeri scholars to talk about the opportunities that Aboriginal knowledge offers for urban and regional environmental management. Michael-Shawn Fletcher is a physical geographer. He's the Director of Research Capability at the Indigenous Knowledge Institute at Melbourne University and an Assistant Dean in the Faculty of Science. And Kate Harriden is a researcher with the Monash Sustainable Development Institute. Her specialty is in urban water management, practices and policy. Welcome to you both.
G'day, how are you going?
Thanks, Dennis, Bill.
And we have an audience here in Queen's Hall. We'll be taking their questions a little bit later. But we'd also love to hear from you. If you have questions for our two panellists, then just pop them in the chat function on our Facebook page, and we promise we'll get to those a little bit later as well. Now, to kick things off, I'd like to welcome Dr. Tien Q. He's the co-chair of the Victorian Parliamentarians for STEM. Tien, if you want to say a few words of welcome.
Thank you, Bill. Before I begin, I also want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land that we are gathering here today and elsewhere in Victoria, and also pay respect to the elders, past, present, and emerging. And today, I, as the co-chair of the Parliamentarians for STEM, I am very honored to be here and also to welcome you all here for the audience here as well as those from following the event from home. This is one of the series of the forum by the Parliament, STEM and Society, and today the topic is about science and culture on country. And also this is a very special event, particularly in the last day of the NAIDOC week, and also in very soon in August, we have a science month and week as well. So this week recognizes and appreciates the cultural significance First Nation people bring to the country, and the theme of this year was get up, stand up, and show up. And this is exactly what we're doing here today. Today is about showing up to acknowledge the negative impacts on the environment caused by our uncritical and recent thinking about land, water, and ecological management. Today you will hear about how indigenous knowledge and Western science both have enormous worth and are finally starting to intersect. Today we are joined, as we introduced, by two wonderful Wurundjeri scholars, Associate Professor Michael-Shawn Fletcher and Research Fellow Kate Harriden, who will explore this very topic. Our two speakers strike a balance between gaining specific indigenous knowledge and adhering to the academic rigor necessary for professional research practice. Recognizing that this subject is key to the future development and enhancement of our environment, and to not have this forum like this one would further exacerbate the detriment already caused by the lack of conversation and intersection. So to close, I want to thank you to our speakers, the Victorian Parliament and the Royal Society of Victoria for facilitating and contributing to this event. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Tien, for those words. So let's start with the really broad question. Now, both of you obviously have a conventional science background, but you're also applying Indigenous knowledge practices to your work. How do you go about that? What does that mean in practice? Kate, do you want to?
In practice, it means that you have to really engage with relational accountability, which is described by many Indigenous academics as the primary Indigenous science research method. And so that's about you acknowledging there's a whole range of relationships that get you to where you are. So it's relationships with people, more than human, with ideas and institutions. So it behooves me as a Wiradjuri person who operates in this way to be accountable to all ideas. So I need to respect that Western science staff, even though I think we can all readily acknowledge that it hasn't been truly successful in this waterscape. But I also, as a Wiradjuri woman and Indigenous scholar, I need to work with frameworks and ideas from my cultural and intellectual heritage. So just trying to get them to work together. I say together, but honestly, I think it should be probably Indigenous science-led, given these Indigenous sciences were built, created on these lands for these waters. So I'll stop there because I could open up.
Yeah, no, and it's great. Similar to Kate, for me, it's about a positionality. You know, as Jen said, and Kate's intimated that really since the British invasion and the dominance of the Western epistemology and modern science techniques, the country's presided over the rapid rates of species loss, catastrophic fires, environmental degradation, and a whole lot of social and cultural issues. And that's because Western science has a particular rigid view. So by just stepping outside of that view, and the way it works for me, what it looks like is taking the very, you know, typical science grounding that I've got in my kind of, you know, replicability, scientific method, but taking that and then having a conversation with traditional owners and Indigenous knowledge holders and talking about the way they view country, the way they view problems, and then seeing if there's some way that you can carry the two together and approach problems from different perspectives. And I'll give you a simple example is just looking at whether or not a landscape is a cultural landscape or a natural landscape. If you take the Western science perspective, it's almost a dehumanising perspective. It's to assume, okay, let's remove humanity from this, and then following the scientific principle, you have to prove beyond reasonable doubt that humans have created the environment. And the burden of proof there is unfair. It's actually you have to prove unequivocally that humans are the main agents, which is almost impossible in science for most of the time. If you take another perspective and actually chat to traditional owners who have this river of knowledge about where their country they're in and the management they've done, and you propose the question, how do we prove this is not a cultural landscape, you know, given all this sort of background that we know, it becomes very hard to disprove that. You know? And that sort of unveils something very important about science, is it's a deeply subjective pursuit that depends on the angle or the perspective you bring. So the way that it looks for me is to sitting down with traditional owners and truly hoping that they lead the discussion and they lead the question making, or co-constructing that from the kind of scientific grounding that I have.
I think if you speak to the average person on the street and you ask them what science is, they'd say something like being able to replicate an observable environmental feature that happens over a period of time, be that seasons or years or eons. I think we can all kind of agree that science at its core, that's what science is. It's when you start overlaying different cultural and social values. So Western science is very much human-centred. It's very engineering-focused, it's very short-term, it's very much about exploiting and extracting. But if you come to this Indigenous science perspective, it's country-centred. So it's all those relationships that make up country, that centre. It's not the human being, we're just one small part of the question. And the answer, you know, they're more about using local knowledge, local tools, local materials to build small-scale temporary interventions if you want to do something to change the landscape. It's just a very different way of looking at the way that core that we might all agree that is science is done. Lots of yarning. And then come back to what Michael said about evidence. You know, Western science sets itself up as the arbiter of what is right and what is not, about what can be acceptable as evidence and what cannot. And effectively cuts every other way of thinking scientifically out of the loop, right? So it's very arrogant. It's very, look at me. And in the process, all these other ways of thinking about science are obscured, are denigrated, and yet, as I said earlier, the science, Indigenous sciences from all place, is so embedded in that place that it holds much better, deeper, longer-term knowledge with much greater range of solutions available because they're actually from that place space.
I wonder, do you both have an example from your research where, you know, you've been, through talking with elders, you've been able to overturn some precept or some concept about science? Is there an example?
I can give you it's not so much, it's a group that I work with, and the one that really strikes for me is in the sort of archaeological sciences and the environmental sciences. There was a particular site in Ongunai Kurnai country, which is what is called Gippsland now.
Yep.
It's a very famous site, an old site, a cave site, but it perplexed archaeologists because they were viewing occupation of this cave from purely an economic resource model. It was like, okay, people, Aboriginal people, you know, forgetting the fact that humans regularly today do things that make no rational, ecological, practical sense, everything must have had a economic return purpose. But there were some features in this sort of setting and the temporal sequence, and I don't want to dive too much and tell another country's story, but that really perplexed archaeologists. So a new wave of archaeologists came about, so people from Monash, where Kate currently works, and actually just talked to Ongunai Kurnai, and they realised that this was actually a doctor's cave, a magic place. And then by tailoring the way that the new excavations were done, they found all of this evidence that just really backed up both known in culture what the magical practices are, but also what was written down by some of the early explorers and what they observed, you know. And just by actually changing the conversations and the ideas at the start, they just revolutionised the interpretation of this. And how many times that's been repeated across the archaeological history of Australia, and there's this sort of notion that Aboriginal people are a Stone Age cave-dwelling society and da-da-da-da-da because of the simplistic perspective that was brought to it, or a singular perspective, that, as Kate said, is just this kind of arrogant, you know, we're the arbiters of what's right or wrong. So that's the one that stands out to me the most.
And Kate, have you had an experience like that in your research work?
Sadly, no. Because I deal mostly with urban water, and the urban water sector is, to put it politely, quite conservative. But I was at a conference recently where someone was talking about, and I'm a bit average with birds, there's a region honey eater. And they've done 7 or 9 different releases over the last, well, it's taken longer because of COVID, of course, everything's for COVID, but about half of those releases were done with mob of the country that the birds were being released on, and the early releases were done just Western scientific way, we'll train the birds up, we'll do this, we'll release. The releases that were done just Western scientific way were borderline failures. Not every bird died. You know, ecologists. But with the when they released with mob, they were very successful because they'd sat down and had a chat, found out what mob knew about the birds' location, the birds' habitat, the birds' behaviours. So all these white ecologists sitting around talking about the bird as cryptic, which apparently is ecology talk for we don't know a lot about it. But mob knew everything about it. They knew. There's nothing cryptic to the local community about what this bird did, and so those releases were intrinsically and manifestly more successful.
And are you both seeing that reflected more and more in the way science is done in Australia, or do we still have a really long way to go for researchers to know that they need to go and talk to elders before they
engage? I mean, because it's my operational model. It's what I see. But if I step out in my other roles, say within the Faculty of Science or broader, still today, you know, there's these ridiculous situations where, you know, people will get a grant to work on country about, you know, either Aboriginal ideas or on Aboriginal country about X, Y, and Z, and then they'll make the engagement with community, saying, "Oh, hey, we've got a bit of money here," you know, and then sort of have this.
We've got a bit of money left over.
to do this, you know, you want sitting fees? We can't afford that, you know. It's the pace of things. You can understand, you know, the grant cycles, you know, pretty short focused, and everything sort of in a bit of a rush. But we need to actually really shift the model. I think still the majority of science is not done appropriately. Sitting down a year or two before, building a long-term relationship, understanding what community want out of the arrangement or out of the research. You know, if we're all in public sector institutions, and our job is to serve the public. So our research, as much as we love it and it's the most important thing in the world, it should be about servicing society. You know, and for too long, we've just served a particular sector of society and ignored Aboriginal people and understood what they need and want. And many times the values will be shared. Sometimes they come at a different angle, and sometimes it'll be very different. I think whilst it's growing and building, I think the reality is that most science is still conducted inappropriately.
Definitely, and it's really frustrating because when you get up and you stand for a different way of looking at science, you just can often... So I did my PhD at ANU, Australian National University, which again is a nice conservative institution, and people are just flabbergasted. We'll get you real science. We'll talk real science when you want to talk, you know, about water. It's lovely to be sitting up here with another Wiradjuri person, not just another Indigenous person who does science in an Indigenous way, but an actual Wiradjuri person. It is so rare. Like, I think this may be a moment that, like, I write in my journal tonight, and it may be unique in my academic career.
So is that isolating as a scholar? Do you feel a bit like on your own?
Well, yes and no, right? Yes, you are on your own, but no, you're not, right? So one of the things I've done at ANU is established a decolonial research and teaching circle. And it's funny because, sorry to bag the ecologists, but we've got this what is that word? Language is terrible. But like this origin story about the Fenner Circle, we call it the Fenner Circle. One of the non-Indigenous conveners does work with Indigenous mob in both Australia and Vanuatu. And whenever she goes to the mob in Tanami in Central Australia, she spends her first week of limited field work time calming down the community because that bloody frog ecologist has been again. He never asks us what's going on with our frogs. He goes through country where he's not allowed. You know, that's the standard, right? That's the standard. Yeah. And then people will, like us, you know, Indigenous scholars and allied scholars, clean up the mess. And you spend a lot of your time cleaning up someone else's mess rather than doing the science that mob and country wants. Mm. It's definitely isolating and it's really frustrating.
Yeah, and that perpetual two steps forward, three steps back, essentially, you're getting nowhere because you are, you know, and it... If you're, and not an end user, but I don't know what we're going to call, they're not stakeholders, traditional owners, but if you're a traditional owner community working with scientists, and most of them doing the wrong thing, it's just easier for them to say no.
And they will, and why shouldn't they? You know, why wouldn't
even
they?
If you're doing the right thing. So it tarnishes everybody that, you know, and science has been no friend to Aboriginal people through time.
But,
you know, it's the progenitor of the eugenics program, stolen children, grave robbing, all these sorts of things on the back of science, you know. And the kind of inalienable bastion of science that must, you know, must be prioritised over everything else because it's a human discovery and da-da-da-da. But it's just basically been used to oppress Aboriginal people and further disenfranchise them or even eradicate them, really, if we're honest about it. So not only are we dealing with inappropriate behaviours now, we're actually dealing with this long history of what science has done to community, and we're trying to change those perceptions, and you still have people coming in and, well, I'm working on a frog. I'm not working on Aboriginal
I'm not working
stories.
I'm not even on country.
Yeah.
I'm just talking to a frog.
Yeah, so it's, you know, but it's slowly it's changing. And I find actually the biggest barrier I encounter now is either tentativeness or hesitancy on the part of non-Aboriginal scholars and scientists on the way to go about it.
Yeah.
You know? And I sort of say, well, if you're respectful and, you know, in Wiradjuri we have a concept, you know, which is yinjamata, which means slowly and with respect. And it's the underlying philosophy of Wiradjuri people. And there are similar philosophies all over, you know, different countries. And it's just slowly and with respect. You know, and that butts up against the contemporary rhythm of life and the rigours of grant cycles and KPIs and da-da-da-da-da. So something's got to give, and unfortunately it's usually Aboriginal people.
And so where does the change come at the undergraduate teaching level, or does it come with those grant-making bodies that you know, embed dealing with...
Change comes from all sorts of places. Yeah. It can't just be one place. So just back to the boring old Fenner Circle, which is actually pretty profound. I shouldn't run it down. It's Indigenous and non-Indigenous PhD, higher degree research scholars. And in about 3 years, we have now created a group of about 100 people who are way more sophisticated in the way they go about engaging with Indigenous communities. So they understand that it takes time, it takes cups of teas to build that trust. You've got to go slow, you've got to demonstrate yinjamara at the beginning. And when you do that, when it gets to the pointy bit at the end, because you've got the trust and you've built the relationships, things can spin on a dime. But if you don't put the time in at the beginning, you're never going to get the trust, you're never going to get respect, and then you can't get the research that works for country and people.
And the other thing you get from that time and sitting down is you start dispelling this myth that Aboriginal knowledge is lost.
Yeah.
You know, people then, I mean...
Because it was always stolen.
I don't want to sort of dwell on the evils of the past, but you have to tell the truth about the past. Culture was beaten out of people. They were starved with rations if they spoke language.
Thrown in prison.
Yeah. And then so then now we have this situation, yeah, within lifetimes, you know, science has changed its view. Come on board, tell us everything you know. Like, no. You actually have to build that trust, give the confidence that that knowledge isn't going to be appropriated, because then you've got other situations of, you know, I'm sure Tyndale was a nice guy and he gave us that map of Aboriginal languages. But you talk to a community and people like that earn a lot of money compared to what Aboriginal people are off the back of Aboriginal knowledge. You know, so not he was a great people to Aboriginal people, but he still derived significant wealth from that.
And still exploited our knowledge for his own gain and at the expense of mob. Right, and so that's one of the things about change is that non-Indigenous people have an obligation to educate themselves and to find out how to go about engaging with communities or how to appropriately use Indigenous sciences or other knowledges.
But just to touch finally, and I agree with you, Kate, then in your original question, both. You need to be educating kids, yeah. Primary school. My kids in primary school, they need to be educated in this right through the whole sequence. And you need to change institutions. Because we all feel more familiar in places that reflect ourselves. You know, so if you go into a, same in gender, you know, like I think physics has an atrocious record of gender equity. Mm. And young women coming into physics don't see female role models. So they're not, you know, so you have to change it here, you have to change it here.
Yeah, it's all sorts of changes required. It's not one place, there's no magic bullet. It's, we all have a responsibility and obligation.
So I'd love to hear a little bit about your specific research topics. Now, I know, Michael, you talk about natural archives. Mm-hmm. What are they? How do they inform your work?
Yeah, so a natural archive is a place that accumulates information, environmental information through time. So to give you examples, it might be lake sediments, bog sediments, stalactites and stalagmites, what we call speleothems, the calcium accretions in caves, that as they're forming trap environmental information. So I work mainly on what we call sedimentary archives. That's areas that accumulate material, you know, every minute of the day, all the way through. Some of them are 1 million years old that I'm working on that have been accumulating information. I'll extract those, so take a core of sediment. You may have seen ocean cores and other things that people take to look into the past. And then you use all sorts of different scientific processes to extract what kind of information you want. So I'll look at pollen, which is a reflection of vegetation. And I'll look at things like charcoal, which is a reflection of fire. So they're two of the main, what we call proxies. You said we have a proxy vote, you're voting for someone else. So there's a proxy for vegetation and a proxy for fire. And by doing that through time and using, you know, radioactive techniques like radiocarbon dating, other things, you can locate your changes in time. You can actually start to see how landscapes change through time. And that's been really profound. What the main thing that's come out of that is, particularly in the recent context, is that the British invasion, not only was it terrible for Aboriginal people, but it marks and the period since the last ice age, so the Earth moves in and out of ice ages over roughly 100,000 year cycles. We've been out of an ice age now for about 12,000 years, right? That was a huge environmental shift, you know, like the big global thing. The biggest change that's occurred in the Australian continent since that time was the British invasion and the environmental impact in that. And that's not just from chopping down trees and putting in farms. That's from turning the nation's collective back on country, ignoring it, and the place has just gone, you know, it's like your lawn. Don't mow your lawn for a year. It's the exact same analogy. What's happened now, except it's been over a century.
Because it's interrupted that management of culture that country that Aboriginal people.
Yeah, and not this. It wasn't. And the other thing that's coming out from this, and really, just get this by talking to Aboriginal people, but scientists don't do that. You know, so it wasn't this one glove fits all, one sort of size fits all management. It was really specific management to different parts of country. You know, really, really different across an estate. And if you think about it, if you're living on country, what do you want to do? You want to keep all of your resources within distance. So you'll manage this here, manage that there, manage that. So you've got this kind of like the supermarket on hand, you know? Yeah. And that's all coming out of these natural archives. You can see these sorts of changes, but without a shadow of a doubt, the biggest environmental change that's happened in the last 12,000 years of this continent is the British invasion. And over large parts of our forested estate, that's meant more fuels, more fires, and it's also meant rates of species loss that are now one of the highest in the world.
We're getting a few questions through on Facebook.
Oh, that's great. Keep it up, people.
Now, Kate, I think this one is from Cole, and I think it's probably from you because it's about the asking about the latest in the Lake Conda technology.
Oh, that wouldn't be me.
are you across the,
no,
the sort of
not
aquaculture?
Lake Conda. No.
I can. Yep. I don't know about the latest,
yes.
As in, but you know, I work with the people who. Well, I work with Gunjumara, whose country that is, and the archaeologists who did the kind of excavation for Gunjumara, and that was a great collaboration. And even from Monash as well, worked with Gunjumara, and they told him where they wanted to work, and that's what unearthed this 6,000-year-old eel trap, you know. And essentially, this is amazing, sophisticated set of micro-scale, but over across a whole landscape, land alterations to pond water and keep a landscape wet throughout the year. And to hold eels, you know, and just really, it showed, we think that great engineering feats are the removal of half a mountain and the construction of a giant dam. This was, you know, subtle and some not so subtle manipulations to create basically a food basket that permanently kept thousands of people fed, you know, and then these tiny little breaks in the walls where traps would be put in. Traps of a certain size, specifically engineered long traps that let young ones through that were there to replenish the stock and harvest large ones. They were at different heights in the landscape to activate under different flood regimes. Like, mind-blowing how sophisticated this is. You know, all with the... It was made possible by the lava, you know, because it fragments into these blocks and you could sort of do this sort of thing. And they were actually fashioned. They weren't just sort of random block, fashioned into this really intricate network. And not only in Gunjumara country, right out through to Garryward, which is what's called the Grampians now, all these eel traps. And over much of Southeast Australia, Barorina is another one. These eel traps are all over Southeast Australia. And they're the ones that preserve. There's all these sort of photos from those kind of early explorers of the thatch ones as well, that was equally sophisticated.
And that sort of technology speaks to what I was trying to say earlier about, you know, in Western science, we're all about engineering and over-engineering and making the biggest, brightest. You know, we've got 57 versions of mobile phones. But it can't do something like that.
Mm.
Because that's actually, that's technology. Mm. That's a really sophisticated understanding of the way water goes, the way the earth flows, what you can do with that particular type of rock. And it seems to me that there's this real history of things that are created by Indigenous sciences tend to be very sophisticated, look really simple. I mean, it looks really simple, right? Those things you just, someone's just, like you said, could have just punched a hole in them, not, but works for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and yet we can't get a stormwater system to last for 80. You know? Fed mob for generations.
Mm. Isn't it ironic that, you know, we laud in science the most simple and elegant explanation and theorem, you know, yet we kind of a disdaining of some of these really subtle and simple, and it's got to be complex, you know. So this is real.
It's complex thinking. It might not be complex in its physicalness, but the thinking that goes on is just so sophisticated.
So speaking of stormwater, which is part of your area, what's wrong with the way that we deal with urban water now?
Probably quicker if I answer that question to say what is right about what we do with urban water. Not a lot.
Right.
Look, the big problem with urban water is that we want to call it urban water. So again, this is this Western idea that everything's carved off. So you've got a sewage supply, you've got a potable supply, and you've got a waste stormwater supply. That just doesn't happen in Indigenous sciences. It's all water. Some of it does this sometimes. Later on, it might do that, but it's all water. I remember when I started using Indigenous sciences in Thailand, and it was where I first started working with Indigenous sciences, was in Thailand. And my Thai skills are quite good, and I was trying to explain to people what stormwater was. And people in the provinces, not, you know, the Siamese in Bangkok, but non-Siamese people in the provinces were like, "You do what? You do what with that? You put a lot of pollutant in it and you flush it really quickly to where you just dump it somewhere where you can't see it. That's crazy."
Mm.
That's the problem, right, is that we can carve off any portion of water and put it aside purely as a waste product. We don't even try to do anything with it first. We funnel all of the land-based rubbish from the soil and the catchment into the water part of the catchment, and then dump it somewhere where we can't see it. That is just, even without knowing that Australia is like the second driest continent on the planet, that is just a fundamentally stupid way of thinking. Right? It fits so nicely within capitalist economics. It fits beautifully within Western science where you extract and you exploit. So basically we're exploiting a large portion of fresh supply of water so that people don't have to manage their rubbish on land appropriately. Do I need to give any more examples of what's wrong with stormwater?
So I know, I mean, obviously we've put a lot of concrete lining down the...
And that just suffocates country. It kills all these environmental processes.
And there are some places, I know, like Moonee Ponds in Melbourne, they're ripping that concrete out now. Is that, I mean, would that improve our management, just ripping the concrete out, or do we need to do a lot more?
Ripping the concrete out is a lovely start, and I think we need to do a lot more. My main concern with this re-engineering of the landscape, so when you rip the concrete out, it's called renaturalising, and when you expose a stormwater or a creek, so all stormwater channels are creeks. It's really just that simple. Don't be deceived. The creeks are rivers. And so if you've got them in concrete pipes underground, it's just a creek that's been smothered. And so when you open that up, that's called daylighting, when you open a pipe that's been put underground. So my main concern about daylighting and renaturalisation is they're so over-engineered. I've seen engineers get really excited and they will plot corners. Like, creeks do their own thing. They're already sinuous, but they will plot the course of the creek and they will build the course of the creek. That, again, is just this human-centric, exploitative, extractive, engineering approach to science when really... I fully understand that because of the way we've developed urban environments, we can't just rip up all the concrete. There will be some management required. But to totally engineer the next 3 km of the creek's course is just another example of over-engineering.
Control.
And so to go to your work, Michael, you were talking about finding charcoal in that sediment, which is evidence of burning. Mm. I mean, I think that's one area where we've seen a really big spike in interest in Aboriginal land management is you know, how fire was used on country. Mm. What are some of the things that you've learnt from your research that you think could be applied to, you know, protecting country against bushfire?
Yeah, that really the the dominant narrative in society or that we live in today about fire is one of suppression. If you look at our fire agencies, they're paramilitary organisations with sergeants and, you know, all this and containment lines. And it's really just designed around suppression and control. The thing that needs to happen is that fire needs to be brought on board as a tool, and not just with hazard reduction burning, which is a bit around assets. Once again, it's a human centric, around assets, around property. You know, sure, we need to prioritise life and property and these sorts of things. Then we just neglect the rest of country. And what the work is revealing is that no matter where you are, some kind of application. So there's maybe some pockets that fire was kept out, and that's still management. You know, there are pockets, say, in the top end where I've worked with community to burn and protect for spears and all these kinds of things. But fire was used in a nuanced way all over. And that totality of that effect was just lower fuel loads across the landscape, diverse environments across the landscape, which gives you your metadiversity, if you like, that gives you your species diversity. And less fires. You know, in Crowaging along National Park in Gippsland, on Gunai Kurnai country, right next to what's called the Crowaging along Wilderness area, a recent study we've done there showed that there were no catastrophic fires, no big fires for about 1,500 years. Then within decades after the removal of Gunai Kurnai management, there were huge hot fires that not only burnt, well, and just before that, eucalypts doubled. Huge hot fires that not only burnt the ground, but they burnt country, and you see these massive erosion events. So they're actually hurting and damaging country just because we've now concentrated our energies into areas, had a misunderstanding about what fire is in this place, trying to put it out. And now we've got this economic model where we want more done for less input. Mm. So we're having two teams driving around the Gippsland forest trying to manage that whole area, you know? So the desire I have is to see all mob back managing country. But the trepidation there is that various communities are at different stages of preparedness. And we have all these pots of money, and so the $21,000 that the government gave to Victorian Aboriginal communities to pilot cultural burning, amazing. But there are some communities who are up, Judge Aburung, for example, they're amazing. You know, they're up and running and they're burning. Gunai Kurnai are at a stage, Tunurunga at a stage, Wurundjeri at a stage. There's various communities out there who are way at different points of their journey. And, you know, they haven't even got a CEO or some kind of structure that can deal with that. Mm. And there's this danger, I think, of recognising what country needs, which is management by Aboriginal people, and then an over-expectation on what can be delivered because capacity's not there, and not taking the time, yinjimara, time to work with communities, build their capacity up so that they can come on just like you would. You wouldn't go and put a novice in as a CEO of a major company. It'll fail, you know?
And it just becomes another opportunity to set us up for failure. Mm. And take stuff away. But the interesting thing about the interest in fire from the non-Indigenous community is that it's not yet being matched by interest in Indigenous water. And yet there is a very clear link, again, in Indigenous sciences between fire and water. So you can actually manage fire to manage for water quality outcomes. Mm. So a really big problem in Australia when you have major fires rip through catchments is you have really poor water quality. But there are burning knowledges across various... So I talk about Indigenous sciences, right? So Wiradjuri had their own Indigenous science because our country was different to Gamilaroi, who had, I mean, high level, very similar, right? But the local practice for that reach of that riverbed or for that particular floodplain, practices were probably different, right? But there was always this connection between fire and water because Indigenous sciences aren't physics, chemistry, geography. It's physics, chemistry, geography. So that knowledge is existent in communities, but is not even really recognised in the non-Indigenous science space yet. Like they see fire and they see water.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's some work I'm doing with my role at the Indigenous Knowledge Institute around what healthy country means. And invariably conversation turns to family, community,
language.
You know, language, all this kind of stuff. Whereas really, agencies consider a healthy country, they've got this checklist of biophysical values, tree cover, species,
water quality.
It's actually much more.
So much more.
And this kind of, and as Kate mentioned, this segmentation of the world around us and then pulling levers to try and control breaks down, the whole thing breaks down, you know, sort of in bringing it all in together, people, science, and you see this when people do cultural, but I've never done, have you seen hazard reduction burn, high vis, you know,
what's going on here?
You see a cultural burn and our kids are there, you know, but it's all, I'd be more happy and safer with mulch.
Very low and slow when I've seen it done. Yeah. We've got some more questions coming through on Facebook, but also if people want to ask questions, Mike has a question. I'll just go to one more from Facebook first. Melanie is asking this. Thanks, Melanie. What are the land management benefits of acknowledging and using Indigenous definitions and knowledge of seasons rather than the European model of spring, summer, autumn and winter? Is that something that, you know, it would be better applied, Indigenous idea about seasons?
Yeah, I talk about this a lot. Yeah, that many times you hear someone say, oh, summer's late this year or winter's late this year. And it's, once again, it's a colonisation of time.
Yeah.
You know, it's this happens to happen here. This week here is for this, you know, and that's built, that had a very specific origin in Northwest Europe where there's a very predictable environment. So there's some minor variations of the Gulf Stream, all this sort of stuff, but they have a moon, the harvest moon that you can harvest your crop on. It's regular, right? So they could do this. They could segment their year into predictable, repeatable. We all know here, you know, what are we into our third, maybe fourth La Nina, you know, there's all these kind of rhythms. And you need a more sensible approach to understand what's happening and when. I guess modern science calls that the phenomenological approach. You know, so when this does this, you know, this is ready. You know, and you see this all the time. So it's more than just tokenistic language change. Ah. It's a complete mindset change.
Total.
That you can't plan your hazard reduction burn a year in advance to be February 4. You know. It may not be for a year or two because it might not be dry enough. It may be that you need to do three or four then, you know, and you need to follow the cues that country lays out for you, not summer, autumn, winter, spring, you know.
Well, that comes back to what I was saying earlier about these sciences are from this place for this place. So if you're coming across from northern hemisphere and you have a harvest moon, you'd be mighty confused not to have it here. But for some reason, you're still named a harvest moon in this country. But if they had have just been nice and said in local language, when is a good time to harvest? Daisy Yam. Mum was pretty generous, radically generous people. They might have said, well, we do it under this, after this, and then Australia, as we know it today, or Australia, would be vastly different, right? Rather than sticking to this, I just think it's crazy because in Canberra, we don't have summer in December. The summer is really the end of February and early March. Mm. Mob would know that, you know, but everyone's going, oh, it's really cold for summer. It's like, well, it's December.
It's like calling Darwin in summer.
Yeah.
Has anyone been up there? It's wet.
That's right. And it's interesting because the seasons are so out of whack in the Northern Territory with the Northern Hemisphere that locals, like non-Indigenous locals, have had to actually go wet season, dry season. Right? They cannot stick with the... Because it's just cognitive. This isn't right. Your brain just goes, this isn't right. It's pissing down rain. This can't be summer. You know, so it's a deep, different way of thinking.
Thank you. Look, I'm so grateful to you both for laying all this out for us, Kate and Michael. This is a fantastic conversation. I'm really enjoying it so far. Just in terms of getting some thoughts around how Indigenous knowledge base, which is so deep and so place-specific, is finding and how science is trying to find its way back, I guess you could say, to that local, place-based, culturally-based, culturally-enmeshed knowledge traditions and intellectual traditions that you've laid out. It's worth... I just noticed that both of you are geographers, right?
Mm-hmm.
From a your scientific basis is as geographers. And geography is this incredibly multidisciplinary...
It's a fantastic way, yeah.
It brings together demography, it brings together landscape management, it brings together hydrology...
It's all about spatial allocation, who gets what, where and why.
Exactly.
That covers everything.
Is that the sort of the sweet spot where science and Indigenous knowledge can really find each other?
Yeah, I would never put a one-to-one, just like I would never seek to try and provide scientific validation for Indigenous knowledge and song lines and things. But if there was an academic tradition that came as close to Indigenous knowledge,
that was capable of doing it.
It's geography. And that's, I'm not just saying that as a geographer, but it does. It considers everything. You know, it considers the human dimension, the physical dimension. Like in my day job, I have to be an earth scientist, a climatologist, an ecologist, an anthropologist, so there's a whole range of things.
And it's interesting how many Indigenous scholars end up in the world of geography. Mm. Like it speaks to us more than many other of the academic traditions, I think, because we do tend to look at things in a much more holistic. And geography allows you that, all those interconnections. And geography also is one of the few disciplines that allows you to work legitimately in a transdisciplinary way, so outside of the academy in general.
Yep.
So lots of things don't like you working outside of the academy, maths, you know, physics. They even get a bit upset with like interdisciplinary, but to actually step outside of the academy, geography has a lot of space in the intellectual tradition to do that.
And just to give people context, I think the microphone died earlier. Yes. My question was about, for those watching online, is geography the discipline where we can sort of bring Western science, I guess, together with an Indigenous tradition of intellectual and, science as well?
Yeah, and not only. I mean, there are biologists and, ecosystem scientists, all these sorts of people who do and can. But I think in terms of that kind of really integrating the human and non-human dimensions in a meaningful way, I think geography gets there closest.
Yeah. Thanks. That's awesome.
We had another question from the audience, but I'll get a Facebook one first from Jerry. Thanks, Jerry. Is exploitation and appropriation of First Nations science knowledge an issue once Western scientists learn from it? Do we need Western science, Western copyright laws to protect it, or is that a paradox? So, I mean, appropriated...
Understand the question. And my response would be, yes, knowledge is exploited and extracted, and this may be controversial. No, I'm not a fan of putting Western intellectual protocols over Indigenous knowledge, which is not to say that I don't think there should be protections for Indigenous knowledge and the use of Indigenous knowledge, and I certainly think there's a lot of room for scientists and other academics, well, not just academics, but coming from an academic headspace today, to engage more appropriately and respectfully with Indigenous peoples and their knowledge systems. But to think that we can solve this problem by using a Western construct is the same flawed arrogance that I've raised several times today and have bitten my tongue on several times today, because it comes up all the time. But why would you think that trying to solve a problem using the system that caused the problem would solve the problem? Mm. That's my fundamental question about most of the stuff that I do. It's one of the reasons I don't want to use Western science to solve the stormwater problem, because it's Western science that gave us the stormwater problem. Like, it's the way Western science works that constructed that. It's the way Western thinking works that constructed the idea that we need to protect Indigenous knowledge. And it's kind of like sexism. You get benevolent and toxic sexism. And the benevolent sexism is about men being nice to protect women from men being aggressive. But it still runs women down. It still limits women. Mm. So Western science has spent all this time telling Indigenous science it doesn't exist. And now that it wants something from us, it exists, but it can only exist in a certain way. And by the way, we're going to protect this thing that we now recognise after ignoring for 200 years. We're now going to protect it with our own legal protocols, not with Indigenous legal or cultural protocols. I'm glad there's laughing in the room, because I think people understand it's a colonisation was not an event. Mm. It is a structure. Mm. It happens today. This very second, you know, that kind of questioning is another kind of colonial. If we're going to come to your way, can we do it in a way that makes us feel safe? Yeah. Question.
And verges on gaslighting as well.
It is a little version of gaslighting.
Yeah, but we're constantly forced into the, like, and once again, I'll say something that it may be controversial, but not that controversial, I don't think, is we're forced into notions of land ownership in order to get our way. Like, it's not in our cultural paradigm to own.
Custodians.
Country owns us.
If anything.
And we have this obligation. But if we go up like that, the court says, well, you don't own your land, and bang, someone else can do what they want with it.
And it's been used time and time again against the order.
It's so true. And now I just want to just go on a slight tangent, because a lot of people don't realise this, that in the British legal system, there's four ways you can acquire land. It can be through inheritance, purchase, conquest, right? Or you occupy unoccupied land, you take over. Now, the two there, right, if you recognise it's a conquest, the legal structures in the British system mean that you have to take on local laws and customs and run your land according to those, right? Mm. Otherwise, if it's not occupied, you don't have to do anything. That's why this place was called Terra Nullius, and the response to that. So there were people here, and they were recognised as people here, there were laws and customs here and approaches that under the legal system should have been recognised, but they weren't. And the way they got around that was by saying we weren't there, you know. And now we're forced into this kind of gaslighting, or, you know, appropriate thing saying, well, you know, you've got to say that you own land if you want it, or, you know, if you want your IP protected, you've got to do it our way. Like, the whole thing is just
totally warped.
Deeply
like, it's totally
screwed,
warped. You know? Like, we're using non-Indigenous terms to describe Indigenous concepts and to protect our knowledges.
And now, I know one thing that you are interested in is the notion of aquanullius. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you about that in a second. We have a question in the audience, though. Do you want to come up first? One? It's working. It's working.
Yeah,
now.
I'm with you, sir. I try to get away with it too, but in this world of hybrid meetings, you need to speak to Facebook et al.
All right, I'll try. My name is Jude Di. I want to thank you, Kate and Michael, for the major work you're doing to advance Indigenous science. So I'm very curious to know about the youth's involvement. I know you talk about, working with Indigenous people, you have to build that relationship. We come with trust, you know, but I don't know if you have ever worked with the young people during the course of your work in the Indigenous community, and if yes, what is their level of contribution?
It's a great question. So in my capacity at the university, in the Faculty of Science as the Associate Dean, where there's this trajectory in the sciences, particularly, of Aboriginal students not engaging with science, you know, it's just alien thing because of all sorts of reasons, you know. So we're working actively to engage kids at a really young age to try and bring them along into the science journey in that education sense. And that we're trying to do that all the way through, not to get people into university, not to feather the nest of the university, just to bring people understand the wonder. I mean, what kid doesn't like a robot, or what kid doesn't like...
Dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs, or, you know... But for too long, you know, like Aboriginal people have been marginalised from this and kept out of it, you know. So we're working hard in that space to try and make science relevant, translate it, so that, and then we get more people in positions with better opportunities and the world changes. I'm a big advocate of you need young people coming in through with all the right kind of cultural and societal skills to make a real change. Otherwise, you're expecting the system, as Kate said, that created the problem to try and solve the problem, you know, without getting new people through. So that's what I'm doing with the youth.
I do similar things, not a lot with young people, but the interesting thing about young Indigenous people is that they're a growing cohort. Indigenous community in Australia is a very young community. The last census, we've just gone from 3 to 4% of the population. Used to be 100, but that's okay. and so that instantly suggests there's lots of young Indigenous kids. Most of them live in urban environments. So they're getting a lot, hopefully, the same sort of stuff that non-Indigenous kids would get, with extra encouragement from Indigenous student-type networks and stuff. And lots of universities are focusing, trying to bring Indigenous kids through. That's the sort of stuff I've been involved in, is just sort of like being a face. You know, hi, this is an Indigenous scientist. You too can be one as well. But as Michael's already said, that knowledge that the colonial community tried so hard to take from us still exists. And there's a lot of education happening in households, on country, around local areas. So, you know, mum or auntie will tell their daughter that this is such and such for this purpose. So the knowledge is still being transmitted and developed.
So in the real sense, that misuse intervention through the primary school will work better than just going...
Oh, yeah. As we said before, I think you need all of it. But I'm interested in that primary school, the things we're kicking in around grade 4 and 5, so that there's this interest, so that when they get to the point where they can choose subjects, maybe they'll pick science, or it won't be just about... Because we're often driven by what influences our lives, and you end up with a lot of Aboriginal people in kind of the social justice space, because they've been... You know, disenfranchised and treated badly. I want to give them the opportunity for any path, you know, not limit them. I'll give you an anecdote. Sorry to overspeak. We were just up in Yitakala working with traditional owners up in the northeast, or meeting with them. Kids there and adults can speak 3 or 4 different languages.
Amazing.
They're flipping in and out of different epistemology, like amazing. You know, I'm sitting there going, whoa, you know, like the capacity of just kids in general, but you know, like the of Aboriginal kids that we were meeting and adults. Is just profound, you know, like the capacity is there. It's what happens in their lives that ends them up in not realising that opportunity, you know. So it's really about changing the structures around them and trying to get in early, I believe.
I think there's always been an assumption in this society that Indigenous people don't value learning. And I think that's something that is built into that deficit model, right? It's built into the notion that we need to give Indigenous kids more opportunities. What we just need to do is recognise that Indigenous communities value learning. It's actually really fundamental. And if you're in an oral society, learning is done differently, but it's critical. Like, I've never met an Indigenous community or family or individual who did not understand the value and the importance of education. But then you get out to this big wider world, and there's a suggestion in the big wider world that they don't want to go to school. They'd rather sit at home or, you know, talk to the grandma or play with the dog, or there's just, but the reality is that there is a deep desire for knowledge and learning, because that's how we survive for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. So, and that's the kids.
There are a couple of related Facebook
questions.
Hardly
got to any of your questions at all.
These ones are more interesting. There's a couple of related ones where Victoria is asking about how teachers might go about incorporating Indigenous scientists into the curriculum without being tokenistic.
That's a pedagogical question, and there's plenty of Indigenous pedagogies that are out there now. Yep. So I do a little bit of pedagogical research with one of my other hats, and I quite like Eight Ways.
Eight Ways.
Yeah, so Eight Ways.
That's for what age group is that pitched
for teaching?
At?
It's just for teaching.
Just for
and
teaching.
It's in New South Wales, it's used as the primary Indigenous pedagogy.
Yep.
It was created by different groups of Indigenous peoples. So I don't know if anyone's heard of Tyson Yucca-Porter, who wrote Sand Talk. Sand Talk will blow your mind. It's worth reading. It's actually part of his PhD. Does something kind of different now, but there was this large project about Indigenous pedagogy, and Eight Ways is what came out of it. And so there's a bunch of different Indigenous peoples and Indigenous ways of being reflected, but basically there are 8 ways to learn. We need to be incorporating all of them, and that if you do more of it, like on country, outdoors, you'll get better results.
That's a missing part, I reckon, the on country, getting out, out on country, you know, like a...
I mean, you're always on country. We're sitting on country right now, right? Mm. But to be actively engaged with...
Out on,
getting your hands dirty and wet and, you know...
And that doesn't mean you have to travel out to the Dandenongs or whatever it is.
Go to your local park.
Just get out.
The nearest creek.
And bring in... And also... You got to pay. You got to resource these things. You know, you can't just keep going to Aboriginal communities saying, "Hey, you coming for an afternoon?" You know,
we'll give you a cup of tea.
Yeah,
yeah.
Pay commensurate to their knowledge and their importance. So.
Now we are almost out of time, but
we've just barreled through.
I did want to get to this question of aquanullius, because I hadn't heard the term before. Can you tell us about what it is and how it would apply in Australia?
So it applies in Australia. It's not how it would apply. It's how aquanullius is the policy by which water allocations, all water policies are done under this. Yep. It's an unofficial policy. So we've just discussed aquanullius, the idea that the land was empty and owned by no one, aqua being the Latin dead language for water. So the water belongs to no one. So if the water belongs to no one, then people who came in and took this land didn't need to ask any questions about how to manage this water, who may have already owned this water, how this water might have been valued or used previously. So this work was done as a PhD research project by, I'm very proud to say, one of my PhD supervisors, Virginia Marshall. And she's a lawyer, and so it's very legalistic. And if you read the PhD, it's just like so versus so the whole way through. Like, there's just so much legal stuff. But the book is much better for those who aren't into all the legal jargon. There's a fabulous section there on Indigenous ontology about how it is that we relate to water and understand water. This is what I can come back and say with absolute confidence, that water has life. Water does not give life. Water is not life. Water has life. And this is not just for Indigenous peoples across this flat-bound continent, but Indigenous peoples across many continents. Aquanullius, basically because the colonists thought that no one owned the water because we didn't exist, that therefore they didn't need to ask anything about it, so they can go about and make water policy any way they do, and that's not changed since 1788. I think the consequences are fairly obvious. Because people talk about a water crisis, but it's actually a crisis of management. If we were managing water in a very different way, I could speak to this for hours. I can see you trying to get me to wrap up.
No.
We could manage water much better if we looked at it from a different lens, and I would suggest the Indigenous water science lens.
And just a final thought from both of you about what do you want people to take away from something like this, or from when you speak to people who are involved in science or involved in management of country, what message do you want them to get?
I'll dovetail off what you said just then about it. It's not it's a management problem, not a water problem. I think science as it is, you know, it's just a method. You know, for me, and I think this is what science is you observe, predict, you know, observe, modify your predictions. You know, that's what it is. So science itself is this kind of essentially a something without a personality but it's the culture is the issue. So, for example, catastrophic fires in this country are a cultural problem, not a climate problem. Climate's making it worse, but it stems from a different cultural perspective on the way landscapes are managed, you know. So it doesn't, that starts with you. Each individual person can interrogate themselves. It's not, oh, okay, we've got to wait for science to change the way it's done. No. It's the way that you think and how you use that science or use that tool. Science is a tool, that's what I was looking for. So for me, I think the thing that people need to start doing is saying, okay, what is it about my life, my upbringing, that makes me think a particular way?
Mm-mm.
How might I, if I was from another life and upbringing, think about this differently? What does that then mean about my quick decisions about the reasons for something or the purpose? And that way we can get the change. Without changing that culture around the way that we view the world, we're just going to continue to drive this continent into the ground. You know? Well, it is in the ground, but, you know, we're going to make it, you know, destroy it completely. So that's I think, is the take-home for me.
I guess for me, my take-home for today, for this event, would be science matters, but the way you do science matter really matters. Mm. So I agree entirely that core of science is kind of, not neutral, but it's kind of standard, right? There's a fundamental way stuff has to be done for it to be considered science. It's the culture that comes on top. That's what matters. Do we want to keep going on being human-centric, exploitative and extractive? Or do we want to stop yinjamara, nurumbang, like respect country, go slow, centre country? I think the answer's obvious, but I'll leave it to the room.
Well, fantastic. Thank you so much both for joining us. Can you thank our
thanks for coming.
Two speakers, Michael and Kat?
Doesn't this smell lovely?
And thank you so much to our audience here in Queen's Hall and to all the people who are watching along. I'd also like to thank our broadcast team who help put this event together and the Auslan interpreters. We hope that we'll join us for our next Facebook Live event, but from all of us here at Parliament House for now, thanks very much for tuning in and bye for now.
Thanks, see ya.
Thank you.